Welcome to EPG Pathshala. In this module, we will discuss about biodiversity and its various aspects. Now, coming to the introduction part, the word biodiversity comes from the combination of two words, where bio means living and diversity means the variation. Hence, in simple words, we can say that the variation among the living beings is called biodiversity. The diversity ranges from very small size microbes to large size mammals. In the most widely used system of classifications, these have been divided into five main kingdoms. First is Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae, and Animalia. Based on certain common features, and are further subdivided into many categories. However, regardless of their size, each organism plays a unique role and is important for ecological balance and environment. As per scientific estimates, a large number of organisms have become extinct from the earth since the time of formation due to various oral processes, natural processes, but in the last 100 years, the rate of extinction has increased due to anthropogenic activities. Keeping in view the extreme importance of biodiversity, it is important to conserve it. The current module will make the genesis of this biodiversity and conservation chapter. It will discuss in brief about the biodiversity, its importance, characterization, and causes of extinction. Coming to the definition part and importance of biodiversity. Biodiversity is the divergence of all species on our planet, such as different species of plants, animals, and microorganisms, including their gene pool, that is genotype, and different ecosystems. The term was defined as contraction of biological array by E.O. Bilson in 1985. Or in other words, we can say that biodiversity is the existence of diverse types of ecological habitats, different species, and variants of organisms and genes adapted to different environmental conditions along with their gene exchange and developments. Next, coming to the global, national, and local dimensions. Historical evolution of the biodiversity. Earth was formed around 4.5 billion years ago. Initially, the temperature of the Earth was around 1800 degrees Celsius. However, later the temperature dropped to below 100 degrees Celsius. This decrease in temperature led to the condensation of water vapors and opened the way to form the primordial soup. That primordial soup was the first organic molecules containing RNA molecule. Thereafter, the lipids combined with the organic molecules, that is RNA molecules, to form first protocells. These cells were then later formed the first organisms, and these organisms were similar to the bacteria. Cyanobacteria carried out photosynthesis and produced molecular oxygen. That molecular oxygen further combined with methane in the air, and that combination led to a fall in temperature, causing the extinction of anaerobic bacteria. The eukaryotes evolved around 1.5 billion years ago. Around 630 million years ago, volcanic eruptions led to global warming, which helped in evolution of algae. Thereafter, the Edicaran era revealed the fossils of multicellular organisms. Thereafter, the Phanerozoic era started, and it was around 542 million years ago. This era helped in the evolution of the present-day biodiversity. Five major mass extinctions took place during this period. The largest biodiversity was seen during the Cambrian period, and it was defined as Cambrian explosion. During the Cambrian period, major phyla including Arthropoda and Chordata evolved. Ordovician period was reported around 450 million years ago due to global cooling. The late Devonian period ended after a long 20 million years ago. Permian period was the harshest extinction, which included volcanic eruptions and huge methane production. Nearly 90% of life became extinct. Thereafter, the Cretaceous period ended nearly 66 million years ago due to volcanic eruptions and due to impact of a gigantic asteroid with Earth, leading almost to 95% of the extinction. Now, the latest epoch is known as Anthropocene. This epoch consists of humans. Humans are blamed to be the main reason for the extinction of biodiversity. Thus, from a single species, that is bacteria, which came into existence over 4.5 billion years ago, an estimated 8.7 million species have evolved and they are populating the planet today. Among them, only about 2 million, that is 14% of the terrestrial species, and 9% of those are from the marine environment species, have actually been described and classified by scientists. This tremendous number and variety of species that exist on our planet is referred to as biological diversity or biodiversity. Now, coming to the values of biodiversity. Biodiversity has certain important values. The components of biodiversity are interconnected. If there is any change in the composition and abundance of the species that make up an ecosystem, can alter the services and also the values that can be obtained from the system. Quantification of biodiversity is seen through various concepts. Mainly, the biodiversity is divided into two subgroups: taxonomic diversity, and other measures of diversity include taxonomic diversity is further divided into species richness. Species richness is defined as the number of species present in an ecological system. It takes into account only the number and not the abundance of the species. Thereafter comes Simpson Index. This index was introduced in 1949 by Edward H. Simpson. It measures the degree of concentration. Thereafter comes the Shannon-Wiener Index. It was originally proposed by Claude Shannon to quantify the entropy. Shannon entropy quantifies the uncertainty, entropy or degree of surprise associated with this prediction. Thereafter comes species diversity. It is represented as the number of species a community consists of. The effective number of species refers to the number of equally abundant species needed to obtain the same mean proportional species abundance as that was observed in the data set of the interest. It entirely depends on the climatic conditions. Thereafter, coming to the next part, that is the ecosystem diversity. This describes the aggregation as well as the interaction of species with each other and deals with the variation in ecosystem within a geographical location and its overall impact on human existence and the environment, especially during the stress conditions. Next is genetic diversity. Genetic diversity is the sum total of the genetic characteristics in the genetic makeup of a species and is distinguished from genetic variability, which describes the tendency of genetic characteristics to vary. Now, the magnitude of the variation increases along with the size and other environmental parameters. Thereafter, the biodiversity divisions. Whittaker, a scientist, that divided the diversity into three classes: alpha, beta, gamma. Alpha diversity tells the species diversity in a given community and depends upon species richness and evenness. Beta diversity describes a range of communities formed due to replacement of species. This situation arises why? It arises due to the presence of different microhabitats, niche, and environmental conditions. Third is the gamma diversity. It describes the diversity of habitat over a total landscape or geographical area. Thereafter, we will discuss three terms: biodiversity, stability, and resilience. biodiversity and ecosystem services. The various anthropogenic activities, they have resulted in the loss of biodiversity and also resulted in the high rate of extinction of rare species. It is anticipated that if this trend will continue in the coming decades, and moreover, if quick steps are not taken up for the biodiversity and environmental conservation, biodiversity loss will be more. Biodiversity loss can threaten the equilibrium of the ecosystem services on which humans depend for their survival. For example, plant species are the primary producers in the food chain, and all the animals depend on them for their food supply. As primary production reflects the rate at which carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas, is removed from the atmosphere, this also decides the availability of the food and rates of climate change. Resilience is indicated by the ability of an ecosystem to return to its usual state or original state following a disorder or other disturbance. Now, biodiversity characterization and inventorying. Taxonomic approach. Now, characterization is done by a taxonomic approach. Taxonomy is the way of recognizing different species under different categories and orders of classification. Mayer, a scientist in 1969, defined it as: taxonomy is the theory and practice of classifying the organisms. It has basically four components: the classification, the nomenclature, circumscriptions or descriptions, and identification aids. Taxonomic hierarchy is pivotal for its value in characterizing species diversity. It provides a reference scheme. Now, this scheme documents the summary, storage and retrieval of information about all the organisms that have been classified. In addition to this, the hierarchy also provides a natural system and elucidate presumed pathway of evolution and pattern of resemblance or any sort of divergence among the organisms. Thereafter comes the cryogenetic approach for the characterization of the biodiversity. What do you mean by cryopreservation? Cryopreservation is a combination of two words, that is cryo and preservation. Cryo means liquid, super liquid, and preservation means to store. Therefore, cryopreservation is a technique that is currently available to ensure the safe and cost-efficient long-term conservation of species. For example, cells, tissues, gametes, oocytes, DNA samples, they can be stored in a genetic data bank for future use. There are two types of technique, classical and new cryopreservation techniques. One thing I would like to clarify, that cryopreservation is always carried out in liquid nitrogen at a temperature of minus 196 degrees Celsius. Classical techniques involve freeze-induced dehydration, whereas new techniques of cryopreservation, they are purely based on vitrification. Classical cryopreservation techniques involve low cooling down to a defined pre-freezing temperature, that is minus 196 degrees Celsius, followed by a rapid immersion in liquid nitrogen. Vitrification-based procedures offer practical advantages as compared to the classical freezing technique, like ultra rapid freezing. They are more appropriate for the cryopreservation of the complex organs, including shoot tips and embryos, which contain a variety of cell types, each with unique requirements under conditions of freeze-induced dehydration. A successful protocol for long-term conservation of two endangered plants, here I am providing an example for cryopreservation, that is Mentisia spathulata and Mentisia vengeri, have been devised through cryopreservation of immature seeds. In case of poultry, as many as 30% of poultry breeds, they are threatened with extinction, and more than 90% have already gone extinct. So it is a good technique of cell culture and freezing method which will give a broad perspective for unlimited storage of genetic resources, which in future can be useful for the restoration of the extinct species, breeds and genes. Therefore, at last I can say that cryopreservation is an effective method that is used in the conservation of poultry breeds. Process of speciation. The process of speciation, it is a two-stage process in which reproductive isolating mechanism arise between groups of population. Stage one includes gene flow interruption. Here, the gene flow is interrupted between the two populations. And second, absence of gene flows allows population to become genetically different. As a consequence of their adaptation to different local conditions, here genetic drift also acts. As the population differentiate, reproductive isolating mechanism appear because different gene pools are not mutually co-adapted. Reproductive isolation appears primarily in the form of post-zygotic reproductive isolating mechanisms. Hybrid failure. These early reproductive isolating mechanisms are byproduct of genetic differentiation and are not directly promoted by natural selection till yet. Stage 2 is the completion of genetic isolation. Reproductive isolation develops mostly in the forms of pre-zygotic reproductive isolating mechanisms. Development of pre-zygotic reproductive isolating mechanisms is directly promoted by natural selection. Alleles favoring intraspecific fertility will be increased over time at the expense of interspecific fertilization alleles. There comes spatial patterns of biodiversity. Aquatic biodiversity is, it is assumed that origin of life took place in sea. This makes the marine system the richest biodiverse habitat, which plays the most important role in the maintenance of other terrestrial biodiversity. Marine plants includes algae, and these are responsible for the fixation of the carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and production of 65% of the oxygen. The different zones of sea, such as benthic zone, pelagic zone, necritic zone and intertidal zone house, have different species of animals and plants. The global spatial pattern is concentrated at the Indo-Malay archipelago, and from this place it gradually decreases in all directions. As like terrestrial biodiversity, marine biodiversity also decreases progressively towards the pole. However, extreme southern latitude is highly rich in marine biodiversity. Then comes the terrestrial biodiversity. The conservation scheme may be understood by spatial patterns of biodiversity. Alexander von Humboldt examined spatial patterns of biodiversity through comparisons among elevational and altitudinal gradients. Charles Darwin and Alfred Wallace, they studied the phylogeographic patterns and speciation and endemism of island system. All the studies formulated generalization of the patterns that define decrease of biodiversity from equator to the pole and increase of biodiversity with an increase in the area studied. Patterns allow authorities to emphasize more and more on high biodiversity areas and define rarity of extremely diverse communities. These patterns provide the opportunities to predict the threats of extinction and anthropogenic and natural response to climate change and disturbances. Then comes the microbial biodiversity. Since the past 4 billion years ago, microorganisms have evolved by exploiting a range of survival skills and have thrived in all kinds of habitat. That habitat include cold or heat, radiation, pressure, acidic, salty and dark places. They have been crowned as the originators of all living forms on the planet today. and we can say that they contribute to almost 50% of total protoplasm on the planet, and by far represent the richest repertoire of molecular and chemical diversity in nature. They are the primary contributors of the food chain and are involved in various ecological processes and biogeochemical cycles. In addition, they have created their own special niche in the ecosystem by virtue of their interspecific as well as intraspecific relationships. Their vast diversity is the main reason of their involvement as an essential component of a sustainable biosphere. Microbes are the major workforces perform the tasks of degeneration, recycling of nutrients, production of gases, destruction of waste material and pollutants, etc. They have commercial value also, like for the production of secondary metabolites including antibiotics, hydrogen, methane, bioplastic, and they are also involved in the bioremediation of oily sludge and bio waste. These properties are very, very important for improving environmental and human health. Microbes are the essence of this planet and all life would cease without them. There are many species of microorganisms which are yet to be discovered. Microbiology focuses on two main areas, with microbial diversity as main, which includes the isolation, identification, and quantification of microorganisms in various habitats. Microbial activity is defined as what are the activities of microorganisms in their habitats and how their activities contribute to the observed microbial diverse patterns of distributions. These are often studied in the perspective of environmental factors such as temperature, pressure, pH, salinity, and availabilities of water and nutrients, and the source of carbon and nitrogen. These factors impact microbial activities and they play a very important role in determining the limitations of microorganisms in these natural environments. Next comes the hotspots of biodiversity. In 1988, Norman Mears, a British biologist, coined the term biodiversity hotspot as a biogeographic region characterized both by exceptional levels of plant endemism and by serious levels of habitat loss. Hotspots comprise different regions on Earth which are biologically rich as well as deeply endangered and are characterized by forests and other remnant habitats which have at least, again and again I'm saying, which have at least 1500 vascular plants as endemics. Any area with 30% or less of its original natural vegetation is characterized as a hotspot. In other words, we can say that identification of any region as a hotspot depicts the vulnerability of that region. Around the world, total 35 areas have been identified as hotspots. These areas acquire only 2.3% of Earth's land surface but support more than half of the world's endemic plant species. Endemic plant species are those plant species that are unique to the specific regions on Earth. Approximately 43% of world mammal, reptiles, and amphibian species are characterized as endemic ones around the world. As per IUCN criteria, International Union for the Conservation of Nature, four regions in India have been recognized as biodiversity hotspots. These are Himalayas, that includes the entire Indian Himalayan region and that falls in Pakistan, Tibet, Nepal, Bhutan, China, and Myanmar. Second one is Indo-Burma, that includes entire northeast region except Assam and Andaman group of islands and Myanmar, Thailand, Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia, and southern China. Sundalands, these include Nicobar group of islands and Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore, Brunei, Philippines. Western Ghats and Sri Lanka, these include entire Western Ghats and Sri Lanka. Now, coming to the temporal pattern of biodiversity. factors and processes that are related to the biodiversity, they change time to time from ecological to geological scale. Now, the background rates of extinction of various species over geological time can be predicted only up to a certain level by the knowledge of patterns of biodiversity over time. For most of the human history on the earth, the global biodiversity has been relatively constant except for the last 1,000 years. But the history of life is characterized by considerable change. The estimated background rates of extinction for differently species have been predicted to be roughly 0.1 to 1 extinctions per million species per year. These measurements for the extinction rates of species have been assessed using the length of species lifetimes through the fossil records that range over 0.5 to 13 million years. This data is mostly derived from the taxa that are abundant and widespread in the fossil record and thus probably underestimate the background extinction rates. Now, what are the threats to biodiversity? Why biodiversity is getting threatened or why it is becoming extinct? First is habitat related. Biodiversity is getting threatened due to habitat relation, due to a loss of habitation, degradation of habitat and fragmentation of habitat. Second point is pollution. That may be chemical pollution, light pollution and noise pollution. Due to overexploitation, thereafter comes the invasion of the foreign species, and lastly due to anthropogenic and climate change. And thereafter, the diseases are also responsible for the extinction of the biodiversity. UV radiations, these are the primarily threat to amphibians. Synergistic effects of threats, cascade effects, creation of a tropic cascading domino-like effect or a series of events within an ecosystem in which the primary extinction of a species triggers a sequence of the secondary losses or extinctions of other species. Now, what is biological invasion? Biological invasion is a major threat for the biodiversity. It refers to the introduction or invasion of alien species in any region, which imposes a threat to native species and ecosystem as these alien species flourish at the cost of the nutrition of the native species. These species means these alien species, they can be exotic or introduced, and they are mostly competitive, predating or parasitic in nature. Now, it's very interesting to know that how these alien species are introduced. First is by deliberate means. Second is by import of ornamental species such as lantana, icornia, etc. By introduction of pest and pathogen for biological control, or during unintentional or accidental trade and international transport. For example, weed parthenium was introduced in India with the wheat import from US. The degree of impact of bioinvasion is evaluated in a standard and objective manner through simplified protocols such as ISEIA, Invasive Species Environmental Impact Assessment, Vanderhoven S. Banker 2010 has given this data. This protocol is composed of harmonious sections with different stages of invasion processes, probable spread, establishment of natural habitats, their influence on native species and natural ecosystems. These protocols, they allow to classify species on one of the following three categories of risk. There are three categories, category A, B and C. Category A is blacklist. It includes species with high environmental risks. Category B, it is known as watch list or alert list. It includes species with moderate environmental risk based on existing knowledge. Category C, it includes non-native species, and these species, they are not considered as threat to biodiversity and native ecosystems. Causes of extinction of species. There are two main causes or main reasons for the extinction of species in the world. These are natural causes and second are the anthropogenic causes. Now comes natural causes of extinction, the various factors that are responsible for extinction are climate change. Climate change is the major factor that is responsible for the extinction of the species. Climate influences the species' existence at large scale. The unpredictable temperature rise or a sudden fall and a variation in rainfall certainly affect the life cycle of all species. Those which could not keep up with the fluctuating environmental conditions means those who can't adjust with the changing environment and changing chemical makeup of their surroundings, they vanish and ultimately die. This creates a gap in the food chain. Now, I'm telling you that it creates a gap in the food chain. It's a big problem and it makes the survival of other species that are dependent on those species that have got extinct or have vanished. Now, their survival becomes difficult. Increase in global temperature has invited more epidemics and diseases to the plants. Second cause is the changes in the sea levels or sea currents. It also contributes to species extinctions. Why these changes occur? These changes are due to the melting of the fresh water. Marine life entirely depends on the high density salted water that sinks and forms currents. The spread of ocean floor and its rise also affects the sea level. A small rise in the ocean floor may submerge the nearby occupied land. The volcanic activity inside or near sea may dissolve harmful gases in the water. This mixing changes the chemical composition and makes the life difficult for the marine organisms. Next comes the asteroids. Asteroids are also responsible for the degradation or extinction of the biodiversity. Collision of asteroids with Earth's surface, they completely destroy the impact site and the shock is felt all around the world. Such interplanetary objects, including the outer space and sun, are responsible for the emission of cosmic radiation. Now, it has been hypothesized that excess exposure to cosmic radiation may lead to gene mutation and weakening of gene pool of species in future. Acid rain. Acid rain is formed when the rainwater reacts with the sulfur oxide and nitrogen oxides in the atmosphere. It decreases the soil acidity. Now the flora, fauna and microorganisms that live in the soil, they are adversely affected due to the increase in the acidity of the soil. It can also pollute rivers and takes to a possibly lethal level. Other factor is disease factor or epidemic factor. Every species on the planet has defense mechanism, immune system that has the ability to fight with the diseases. But due to the fluctuating climate, certain species, they lose their ability to fight with the disease or to combat with the disease. Certain species are turning more prone to diseases and epidemics and consequently they are getting become extinct. Spread of invasive species, I have already told about it. There's invasive species, they are threat to the local species of a territory. They compete for the resources with the native species. Once competition gets elevated or pronounced, the mechanism of survival of the fittest works and the weaker section of the species get dies and the stronger section establishes itself. Natural factors usually work at slow pace and contribute a smaller sum towards species extinction as compared to human factors that are responsible for maximum extinction. Now we will discuss little bit about the anthropogenic activities that are responsible for the biodiversity extinction. Human activities are occurring at a faster rate and causes higher extinction rates. Human is the main reason that why the biodiversity is getting extincted. Human activities that are mostly responsible for the present extinction rates are increase in human population, destruction of the habitat of the wildlife, pollution and climate change, and global warming. According to the studies done by the International Union for the Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources, human-induced extinction is not a new phenomenon, but it is becoming more rapid now. Now at the end, I would like to conclude the whole module as the biodiversity is a main factor in the sustainable development of the world and human society. Usually, it is used in a context that stresses the need for attention on our living environment and the sustainable use of natural resources. The loss of biodiversity is imminent if no change is made in the next 35 years. Half of the world's animal species will disappear, and its decrease will be a decisive factor in our planet's future. We have studied in this module about the historical evolution, values of biodiversity, concept of biodiversity, spatial patterns related to biodiversity, threats to biodiversity, and causes for extinction. It is helpful to think of an ecosystem as a woven carpet. If you pull on a loose thread, it might only affect the thread, and the thread closest to it, or it might unravel the whole carpet. Hence, I would like to say that conservation of biodiversity is an important need in today's era. Thank you.